Let's before we start our worship, let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Our Father in Heaven, thank you so much for this beautiful day, the day of worship to you. We pray, Heavenly Father, that we might turn our attention to you and your word, that we might open our hearts, close our hearts to the things going on in the world, and for this time, devote ourselves to you in our praise and our uplifting of our hearts to you, our living sacrifices to you, and give thanks to you, Father, for your great and mighty wisdom. Our Father in Heaven, we ask that you would bless this time of worship tonight. We thank thee, Father, for this opportunity. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Good evening. Could you please grab a songbook and turn to Psalm number 480, Soldiers of Christ Arise. For those online, we are singing out of the Songs of the Church. Again, that is 480.
Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on. Strong in the strength with God's supply. Strong in the strength with God's supply. Through His beloved Son. Stand then His hand.
Before the lesson, may you please turn to Psalm number 88, The Gospel is for All. And if you would like to leave a finger there, you can mark number 600, Psalm number 668, the song after the lesson, 668, Come to Jesus. And now turn back to Psalm number 88.
Of one the Lord has made the race, through one has come the fall. Where sin has gone must go His grace, the gospel is for all. The blessed gospel is for all, the gospel is for all. Where sin has gone must go His grace, the gospel is for all. Say not the heathens are at home, beyond we have no call. For why should we be blessed alone, the gospel is for all. The blessed gospel is for all, the gospel is for all. Where sin has gone must go His grace, the gospel is for all. Receive ye freely, freely give from every land they call. Unless they hear, they cannot live, the gospel is for all. The blessed gospel is for all, the gospel is for all. Where sin has gone must go His grace, the gospel is for all.
This evening's scripture reading comes from Matthew chapter 8, and I'll be reading verses 5 through 13. Again, that's Matthew 8, verses 5 through 13, and it's from the New King James Version. Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented." And Jesus said to him, "I will come and heal him." The centurion answered and said, "Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. For I am also a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, "Assuredly I say to you, I have not found such great faith even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from the east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, but the sons of the kingdom will be cast out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Then Jesus said to the centurion, "Go your way, and as you have believed, so let it be done for you." And his servant was healed that same hour.
I am so humbled and grateful for the opportunity, any opportunities that I have to be able to preach the gospel. I don't get enough. I echo Brother John's comment about the love for preaching the gospel. And I am honored to be able to stand up here and speak tonight about something that I found very interesting, something that I heard not too long ago. I think it was just something in passing in a lesson. I thought, that might make an interesting lesson. About unlikely heroes of faith. And notice I say heroes of faith and not heroes of the faith. What book in the Bible, what chapter in the Bible do we read about the heroes of the faith? Hebrews chapter 11. We sometimes call it the roll call of the heroes of faith, or the roll call of the faithful. Those are man-made words, but they're apt descriptions of what we read of of God selecting these individuals and the things that they did to represent the faith that He is looking for, the faith that He desires from all of us. But there are others that we read in the Scripture. Some of them are listed in Hebrews chapter 11. Others are not. But over time, as I've studied God's Word and as I've prepared lessons, I've become more and more amazed at God's wisdom, and in particular in how God's wisdom, whereas I study, I confront my own biases, in my heart, and what seems to go against common wisdom, I guess you could say, and find out that no, God does not think like that, does not think the way I think, God does not look the way I look. And so we have examples in the Scriptures of some unlikely servants. For example, Rahab the harlot. A harlot. Think about it. Rahab is mentioned numerous times in the Scriptures, and we see that eventually she is in the lineage of Jesus Christ. A harlot. Who would have thunk that? Who'd have thunk that? I mean, that's an expression that I've picked up over the years. What about David, king of Israel? But he was a shepherd boy. He was a good-looking shepherd boy, but he was not of the mighty warrior, his brothers and the warriors in Israel. He was not of that size, and yet he was the one that God chose to be king over Israel. Matthew, a tax collector. The Jews would say, "Pooh, a tax collector." If you ever watched the movie Fiddler on the Roof, you'll know that the spitting part in there, it's rather humorous the way they describe that. But that they looked down upon him. He was a Jew, yet he was working for the Romans as a tax collector. or as they would probably put it, as an extortioner of the Jews' money to support the Romans. But Jesus chose him to be one of his apostles. The enemy of the church, Saul of Tarsus, who later met Jesus on the road to Damascus and changed his name to Paul, he became one of the greatest preachers and one of the greatest workers in the kingdom of the Lord. And yet he would tell everyone that I am the least of all. But yet he was the enemy of the church, and yet Jesus met him on the road and said, I have a mission for you. And then what about Jesus himself? Jesus, the meek carpenter's son. He was not at all what the Jews were looking for the Messiah. They had their own biases. They had their own views of what this Messiah was going to look like. He certainly was not it. And so we see some examples here of God using the seemingly unlikely people in the world throughout history to perform his work. And we look at these examples and think about how the world might have overlooked these individuals as nothing of consequence, people to avoid. Avoid the harlot, avoid the shepherd, the tax collector, and so forth. And let's remember that our biases, and yes, every single person has a bias. Don't say, oh, I'm not biased. Yes, you are. Every single person has a bias because each of us is a unique individual, and we look at the world from our perspective. Now, we can share those biases. We can look in opposition to other biases, but the fact is that all of us have some kind of a bias. And that's not a bad thing, necessarily. It's just the way things are. Sometimes when I describe a bias, I ask my students, what is the best flavor of ice cream? And then I hear all these responses, and I say, no, mint chocolate chip is the best flavor of ice cream. And I'll get lots of yucks about that. But that is my bias. It's my favorite ice cream. But our biases can cause us to judge individuals as seeming to be unlikely to obey the gospel, and therefore we might not bother to reach out to them with the soul-saving gospel of Christ. So this is something that every single one of us needs to confront in our own lives, our own biases. God certainly chose these individuals to do the work that he set out for them. And in 1 Samuel 16 and verse 7, let's remember God's truth here. For the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. We need to practice then looking at the heart. And as we look at two examples of individuals in the same type of job, if you will, a career, that how the Jews overlooked them, would not have even paid any attention to them. And I'm talking about the two unlikely heroes of faith during the time of Christ and during the early church. That is two Roman centurions that to the Jews were not only unlikely to receive God's blessings, but should be avoided at all costs, to be hated or murdered if possible. In fact, in some cases, there were with the Jewish wars. The Jews fought against the Romans, and many people died as a result of their hatred for the Romans. So we're looking at two Roman centurions, some of the characteristics of these Roman centurions. But before we look at those individuals and the circumstances surrounding them, let's take a look at this, what it meant to be a centurion. A Roman centurion was a professional officer. They were not conscripts. But in the Roman army, there was only a period of time where they actually had conscripts. Most of the time, it was a volunteer army. But some of the qualifications to be a centurion was, first of all, they had to have full Roman citizenship. If they did not, they could not serve in the Roman army. There are other qualities that they were looking for. That is, their physical capacity. Were they strong? Were they able to run? Were they able to fight? And things like that. Were they mentally alert? Could they evaluate a situation, especially in combat conditions, and be able to figure out what the best tactic to use in order to defeat the enemy that might be coming around one side while they're getting their cavalry on the other side ready to come after them? They could evaluate that and then thwart the enemy's attack. And the skills. There are certain skills that were actually required of many of the Roman soldiers, but especially for centurions. They had to be literate. They had to be able to read Latin in order to read the orders from those above them, the tribunes and the generals that led the army. So they had to be able to read and interpret these things and understand what it was required of them to do, especially in combat. But not all of their time was spent in combat. A lot of their times in the garrison, they had a lot of bureaucratic work to do, and they had to be able to do that. Hence, the abilities to in arithmetic and in bookkeeping. All of these skills were valuable to become a centurion. And the centurions that became a centurion either by a direct commission, and that was not always the case, but a lot of the times is that they rose through the ranks. They enlisted, they joined the military, and they rose in various positions. There are a lot of different positions. I won't go into all those. It's really interesting, their structure and how we can see our own military structured in many ways after that. But if they were fortunate, that is, if they didn't die in battle or anything like that, but if they were fortunate, they could attain the rank of centurion before they completed their 20-plus years of service in the Roman army. But they had to have at least these certain qualifications. And then all Roman soldiers swore an oath. They swore an oath to obey the emperor and the Senate and to perform their duties under the penalty of death. And part of their oaths, these are some from historical documents, that they swore that they would not run away in flight or out of fear. If you think of the battle on the ground with spears and lead projectiles being thrown at them and fire and so forth, that it can be confusing, but they developed a significant esprit de corps, the spirit of the body, that their unit was the unit that I will die for my unit, and I will not let my comrades down. And so that idea of the esprit de corps was significant in the Roman army and perhaps unique in the ancient world. Certainly, there's a branch of the service that they will be happy to tell you about their esprit de corps, the Marine Corps. But nevertheless, that kept them together as a unified fighting unit, and perhaps part of the reason they became the most fearsome fighting force in the ancient world. But here, they would not run away in flight or out of fear. They would get a sword. If they got captured, they would be put to death right away. That they would not leave their ranks, because if you leave your ranks, you create a gap, a hole, a flaw in the structure of their fighting formations, and thus it could cause the collapse of the whole formation. And that they would attack an enemy offensively or defend a citizen. And all of these things, these are just parts of what they swore as soldiers in the Roman army. Now, hopefully you're thinking about how can there be a spiritual application of this. You think about that. If you think about, you look at the examples in the scriptures of our warfare and the armor of God and our spiritual armor and serving as a soldier, fighting and so forth, that there's a lot of parallels in there. And I tell you, I respect the Roman army for certain aspects of that. Not their brutality, but certain aspects of that which we can apply in the Lord's church. Individually, in the just and again, a legion had between 4,000 to 6,000 soldiers. That's a lot of soldiers. 4,000 to 6,000 soldiers just in one legion. Within a legion, there were 10 cohorts. That was the basic fighting or the primary fighting unit within the Roman army. But then within each cohort, there were 6 centuries per cohort. So there were 60 centuries. 10 cohorts and about 4,000 to 6,000 soldiers overall. And so sentries were down at the very basic fighting unit level, and it required discipline and order in order for them to function efficiently. And why do we talk about that? We're getting to that in just a moment. Just start thinking about these numbers. Start thinking about where they were in Judea. In the Romans occupied Judea starting at about 63 B.C. And from throughout history, throughout the history of we read in the New Testament and in the early church that the Romans occupied as conquerors. The 10th legion was stationed in Judea. Part of the time was in Syria, up a bit to the north, and that'll become significant in just a few moments. And then part of it was headquartered in Jerusalem. And think about that. When we've talked about the difference between the Jews in Judea compared to the Jews in Galilee, how the Jews in Judea looked down on the Jews in Galilee because they were country bumpkins up there in Galilee, and we are the educated elite in Judea, Yet Jesus chose his apostles from among those in Galilee. And so that you could imagine that with this center of power in the Jews' religion in Jerusalem, with the Romans garrisoned there, oh, just imagine how that was like a burr in the saddle blanket, if you think about that. So the 10th Legion was stationed in Judea most of the time, and for part of the time there's the 6th Legion that was later staged there during the Jewish Wars, AD 66 to 78. And those of you may recall, there is another number, 70, AD 70, that fits right in there, and that's the date for the, or the time for the destruction of Jerusalem and the Roman in the temple. So real quickly, in summary, let's think about this. Pull this all together. There's somewhere around 6,000 or more Roman conquerors. Not only that, they were unclean. They were Gentiles, ruling in Judea for almost 100 years during the time of Christ, up to that point. The Romans granted the Jews religious and political freedom to operate, so they were able to perform their worship services, and the Sanhedrin was able to perform their administrative functions. They had certain capabilities to exercise rule of law, but they were only vassals. They were subservient to the Romans. The Roman government said what would go on. And thus, there was a great deal of animosity and a great deal of resentment by some of the Jews. I don't know if I wouldn't say all of the Jews, or certainly not all. And I really can't say most of the Jews, so I would say some of the Jews, and that's a safe assumption. And they continually fought against Rome in the years following Jesus' time on earth. So is this kind of a little bit of a background here? We can understand the circumstances of the Jews versus the Romans there. And this adds to the amazement that we can find in these two particular centurions and the things that they did that we're just about to read about. So the first centurion, we read in Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 13, and there's a parallel passage in Luke 7, verses 1 through 10, and I'll be reading through part of that. This took place in Capernaum. This is if you would call it the place that Jesus called home, or that was his home base, so to speak. He's on the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee, not too far from Cana, where he went to the marriage feast and performed his first miracle there. And he spent time there, fed the 5,000 on the mount, and so forth. So here was an area there this particular centurion lived. And this is the centurion that had the dying servant. In the comparison here, Matthew 8, verses 5 through 13, Matthew records him saying, "My servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented." When was the last time you can say I've been dreadfully tormented with something, with itching or pains or something like that? I'm sure that some of us can imagine, can say that about certain pains, that it's driving me crazy. I can't do anything to get rid of this pain. Imagine that. Imagine that. So that's where that was. Luke, the beloved physician, in Luke 7, verses 1 through 10, said that the centurion servant was dear to him, and he was sick and ready to die. So we can see that the servant was grievously ill. That we learned something else about this centurion. We don't know his name. We just know that he lived in Capernaum, that he had a servant who was dear to him. Now, when you, again, think back to the characteristics of a Roman soldier, not all Roman soldiers were absolutely brutal beasts or anything like that, but they could bring about an immense amount of brutality and torture as they needed to. So the idea, this image of the Roman soldier, I don't care what feathering plumes you have, you're a centurion or a general, or if you just have the metal helmet, any one of you is going to be this enemy. Any one of you is going to be a brutal beast, a brutal animal. But to hear of a man, of a centurion, of an officer, a professional officer of a great deal of responsibility in the Roman army, to have a servant who was dear to him, that tells us a little bit something about his characteristic. And they describe how that he loved our nation and has built us a synagogue. This picture is of the 4th century synagogue that's in Capernaum. It's a ruins that apparently you can visit. Lord willing, someday I'll get to visit there. But excavations in and around that synagogue have revealed a lower foundation that dates back to the first century. And it is possible then that that lower foundation is the same location of the synagogue that this centurion paid to have built. Now, this is huge. A Roman centurion, to the Jews, to many of the Jews, he was an enemy and to be feared and hated and just avoided altogether. Yet this Gentile, this Roman centurion, paid for the construction of this Jewish place of worship. Paid for it out of his own pocket, we presume. Doesn't say that he did, but he paid to have it built. He built it for them. And so can you see the irony there? This enemy of the state supporting the worship and devotional practices in an expensive material way. Quite some irony there. All right, now let's see some things about this that make him different. In Luke chapter 7, if you want to turn there, Luke chapter 7, we'll just skip over a few of the examples here of what we see. First of all, he asked Jesus to heal his servant. In Luke 7, verse 3, when he heard about Jesus, he sent elders of the Jews to him, pleading with him to come and heal his servant. In Matthew chapter 8, it just says a servant centurion came to him, pleading with him. All right, now, these are not contradictory. It's just that Matthew supplies a certain amount of detail, and Luke provides additional detail, that when you combine them, you see the whole story. So he asked Jesus. He heard that Jesus was coming, and he asked him to come and heal his servant. Secondly, the Jewish elders vouch for him. Whoa, another amazing irony there, that they would consider him worthy. In fact, they even say that he is worthy, that he was deserving. Verse 4, when they begged him earnestly, saying that the one for whom he should do this was deserving, for he loves our nation and has built us a synagogue. Amazing right there. So these Jewish elders, that ordinarily, I suppose if they were down in Judea, they would have had nothing to do with him. Go ahead and die, I don't care, because you're a Roman soldier, I'm a Jew, we have nothing to say, nothing further to say. Not so up in Capernaum. So here, the Jewish elders vouch for him. He asked the elders to go to Jesus to ask him this. And then the third thing is that how he respected the Jewish laws and showed honor to Jesus. Luke chapter 7, verse 6. And then Jesus went with them. And when he was already not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying to him, Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Therefore, I did not even think myself worthy to come to you. But say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man placed under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. Now here he is showing some of his characteristics, that he recognized the authority of Jesus and the fact that perhaps somehow he learned about Jesus, about the things that he said, the things that he was preaching, and about being the Son of God, perhaps, don't know, but he recognized that Jesus had power to do things, that he was given power by someone higher than him. I think that's what he was getting at here. That's the idea. But also notice that he respected the Gentile Jew distinction, the difference, the chasm between the two. That I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. I recognize that it is unlawful for a Gentile to come into a Jewish household. So he said, I recognize that. But say the word. That's all you have to do. You don't need to come in and do something amazing with a laying on your hands or calling down light from heaven or something like that other people would say, send me a sign, show me. No, just say the word, and I believe that my servant will be healed. These are amazing things, absolutely amazing characteristics of him. And then we read back in Matthew chapter 8, verse 10, what was Jesus' response to his request? When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. The word marvel means to wonder or to be had in admiration. Jesus was probably, I'm sure he knew his heart because he was Jesus, he's deity. But to those around him, he turned around and he looked at them and said, see this man here? I have not found such great faith in him. And the way, when he marveled, not that he was shocked and surprised, he wanted the people following him to be shocked and surprised. I have not, here's a Gentile, not just a Gentile, but a Roman centurion. And he is showing more faith than any of you among all, or even in Israel. And there were two instances, two occasions we read in the scriptures in which Jesus marveled. This is one of them. He marveled at the centurion's faith. But we read in Mark chapter 6, verse 6, that he marveled at the Jews' disbelief. Again, such a contrast between those two. And then later, as Jesus continued to speak to the people with him, he turned to the servant and he told them, go your way, and as you have believed, so let it be done for you. And verse 13, and his servant was healed that same hour. Here is one unlikely hero of faith. We don't know his name. We just know he was in Capernaum. He was a centurion. He had a servant he loved dearly, and that he asked for Jesus to come and heal him with a word. The great faith of that centurion. The second centurion in Caesarea in Acts chapter 10 verses 1-8, and we know him by name, and his name is Cornelius. So Cornelius, we read of some of his characteristics, but here is in Acts chapter 10. Here is a rough outline of the events that took place, and I'll emphasize the events that took place, and I'll get to that in just a bit. But first, verses 3-8, we read of his vision. Actually, verses 1 and 2, I'll talk about that in the next slide, just briefly there. But his vision, where the angel came to visit him and told him that your prayers have come up as a memorial to God. So send for this man named Simon. He's in Joppa, which is a city farther south along the coastline. Let me back up one slide here. If you see Caesarea, Joppa is just off the bottom of that slide, just down in that region there. But it was right along the coastline. There was almost a straight line road that led there, yet it still took a little time to get there. And so he had this vision, and Brother John had mentioned something about the every time that an angel came to visit someone, there was no beautiful scene and happiness and joy in my heart and so forth. Every time you read in the scriptures of an angel visiting, they bowed down and worshiped, or they were frightened. He was frightened when he saw this. We met that angel. And so while he sent his servants to go get Paul, or Peter, to bring him up, at the same time, or roughly the same time, Peter also had a vision. And this vision was given in an interesting form, with a sheet lowered down by a blanket on four sides, with all sorts of unclean animals and four-footed beasts and so forth. And in the vision, the angel said, arise and eat. And he said, those are unclean animals. I have never, ever touched anything unclean in my life. What God has declared unclean, do not declare unclean. And they did it three times. And in the scriptures, when something is given three times, that usually indicates that is fixed and you cannot change it. This is God. This is the decision. You will do this because I've told you three times to do this. And so while he was pondering this, the guests came and they told him what happened. And so they got Peter and he went. He put them up overnight, which is another interesting thing, because they were like, they may have been Jews or they may have been Gentiles. Don't know. But he showed them the hospitality. They'd spent the day traveling, spent the night. Then the next day they went up to Caesarea. And then he met Cornelius. Peter met Cornelius, verses 24-33. Cornelius bowed down to him. Peter says, I'm a man such as yourself. Cornelius related to him exactly what happened to him. We read that in verses 3-8, almost word for word, what happened to him. And then finally, and then Peter, in verses 34-43, says, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, and began preaching the gospel to him. But what was it? It was in verse 44-48, the thing that convinced him that the significant event that took place, that convinced Peter that the Gentiles were now, that salvation was available to the Gentiles. It was the miracle that took place there. Well, let's take a look briefly at some of the characteristics of Cornelius, some of the things that were said about him. He was a devout man. What does the word devout mean? Devout means that he's reverent and spends his time in thinking of spiritual things. He was devout. And one that feared God with all his house. So it's not just Cornelius, but everyone in his household. There, that tells us some more things about Cornelius and about the circumstances here, that he was an amazing man. But he gave much alms to the people. I suspect that was an amazing thing for a Roman, not much less a Roman centurion to do, because to the Romans, they were extracting tribute from the people, perhaps even extorting money from businesses and so forth. Some of the soldiers that were definitely of a lower class, and they were taking things that didn't belong to them. But he gave much alms to the people, and he prayed to God always. Now there's an interesting point right there. He prayed to God always. When the angel came to visit him in the vision, he said, "Your prayers have been lifted up as a memorial." As a memorial, I've heard and I remember. But he didn't say, "Your prayers have saved you." He said, "Send for Simon, who's staying Simon Peter, who's staying with the tanner in Joppa. Bring him up, and he will tell you what you need to do." And then in verse 22. As the servants were describing him, they also said that he was of good report among all the nation of the Jews. So Cornelius, a lot of things we can learn just about his character. But that's not the whole story. Peter needed to be convinced that the Gentiles were now eligible to receive salvation. And I choose those words in that way because that's almost the kind of attitude. I believe that would have been a way to describe the attitude, was that salvation is to the Jews only, and I don't know about the Gentiles. And yet, when the Christians were teaching the Gentiles at various points, it caused a stir, but it took this event to finally and firmly convince the Jewish Christians who had been Jews, I'll put it that way, in Jerusalem, that salvation was available to the Gentiles. In the vision, it took three times, or part of that vision was three times, not so much he didn't listen to me the first time, all right, I'll do it a second time. I still didn't think of it. So, all right, give it to you a third time. Three times. So the fact that the angel presented to him three times indicated this is fixed in God's mind. Do what you need to do. Secondly, Peter perceived that God is no respecter of persons. All right, so he was becoming convinced, but he was almost convinced, but not quite there. But it was the miraculous demonstration that finally convinced him. And this miraculous demonstration was the Holy Spirit coming upon Cornelius and his household, and they began to speak in other tongues that the Holy Spirit gave them to be able to speak. And they recognized, he and those that were with him recognized, this is what happened on the very first day in Pentecost, the same miracle. And so this miracle was to show Peter, convince him that yes, God says salvation is for the Gentiles. Do what you need to do. Teach the gospel. He says, preventing us from baptizing these people? And they obeyed the gospel, Cornelius and his household. So there are some spiritual lessons that we can learn from the faith of these two centurions. We can learn some things from the personal characteristics, and it's well worth our time to study. For example, looking at Cornelius and certain the character qualities there, or looking at the centurion, the unnamed centurion in Capernaum that spent or that had a synagogue built. And the things that he did for them, and the fact that he was well respected by the Jews there, these are things that we can study and learn from those things. However, there are other spiritual lessons that we can learn that may not be as obvious. In particular, these are lessons from the circumstances and the events surrounding these two individuals. So a couple of lessons. First of all, God looks at the heart, and so should we. We need to not let our biases and prejudices prevent us from teaching the gospel to someone, no matter how unlikely they are to obey. And I would use air quotes on the word unlikely, because we don't know the hearts of men, only God. We don't know who is ready to obey the gospel. We can perhaps see some outward appearances, some body language and things like that, but we cannot say, I'm not going to teach you the gospel because I don't think you're going to obey. Why should I bother? Because you're just going to ignore me. You don't know that. We don't know that. I don't know that. And so we need to be careful that we do not let our biases prevent us from teaching the gospel. Looking at the heart and not at the outward appearance. Secondly, these centurions, these are two examples of unlikely heroes of faith. They had genuine interest in spiritual things, manifested in the fact that one of them paid had a synagogue built, and the other one had done many good things and was of a good reputation among all the people there. That his prayers, he continued to pray, and his prayers were heard by God, who then sent Simon to go to him and teach him. We should be looking for those that are searching for the truth. People that are looking for something that's larger than themselves. Perhaps you've heard someone talk about that, or you've heard that expression before. Is that there's got to be something bigger than me. There's got to be something. In fact, I've even seen billboards advertising things like that. In fact, I think it was a U.S. Marine Corps advertisement about there's something bigger than you. You know, serve the Marine Corps and so forth. But there's something bigger than us, even bigger than that. That is, where will we spend eternity? And why do I need salvation? And how do I get salvation? Men and brethren, what shall we do to be saved? And so these were seekers of the truth. They were searching for the truth. And yet, perhaps most of the Jews or many of the Jews would have just said, go away, you're Gentile. Their bias against the Gentiles would have prevented them from sharing the gospel of Christ. But through the vision and through miraculous means, Peter finally got it. Okay, this is what God wants. I get that now. Another lesson is that God will reward those that diligently seek Him. In Hebrews 11, verse 6, but without faith it is impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Were these two centurions saying, oh, I know that I'm lost in sin, and I need to follow the teachings of Christ and be baptized for the forgiveness of my sins? We don't read that's what they were thinking. But we know that from their actions, their character qualities, that they were searching for something, and they were searching for something spiritual that was beyond them. And thus, God will provide opportunities for those who seek the truth. And He will also provide opportunities for those who are looking for those who are seeking the truth. I remember when I was searching for the truth, and it never occurred to me to search the Bible for the true church. But I finally discovered that I was searching for something, but I didn't know what. I was spiritually minded, and yet I didn't know what I was looking for. And finally, I obeyed the gospel, and then I realized, for the first time in my life, that's what I'd been looking for all along. But it took a brother in Christ to recognize my search and offer the opportunity to study the Bible with him. And from that, I obeyed the gospel, and I've never looked back on that. God will reward those that diligently seek Him. That is, those who are searching for the truth, and those who are looking for those who are searching, looking for those who are searching for the truth. And lastly, only obedience to the gospel saves us. Now, we don't know the end result of the centurion in Capernaum, up in the north of the Sea of Galilee. It is, we could say, he probably obeyed the gospel. We don't know that. I would say that there's a possibility that he did, but we don't know. Many of the Roman soldiers that were posted in certain locations, after they served their 20 plus years, they were able to retire and stay there in a veteran status. In fact, some cases they married women in the local area, and so they had an incentive to serve, to continue to serve the Roman army in an auxiliary format or auxiliary role on the frontiers. Judea was considered one of the frontiers, and so it's possible, but we don't know. We just know that he was a just man and a good man and with great reputation with the people. Cornelius, on the other hand, we know that he obeyed the gospel. It says so in the end of Acts chapter 10. But God sent Peter to teach Cornelius and his household what they needed to do to be saved. The angel that gave the vision to Cornelius did not say, "Your prayers have saved you." He told him to send for Simon. Simon will come. He will teach you what you need to do to be saved, and that he did. And they obeyed the gospel, and they are our brothers and sisters in Christ, presumably. We don't know the rest of the household. But nevertheless, it is only the words of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that teach us of salvation. In Acts chapter 4, verse 12, "Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." It is the words that Jesus taught personally. It is the words that he gave to the Holy Spirit to teach to the apostles and to the Christians in the first century. These are the words consolidated in his word that we can know and understand what it is that we need to do to be saved. We can learn these lessons from the lives of these two unlikely heroes of faith, the two centurions we read about in the New Testament. What is that plan of salvation? Romans 10, verse 17 says that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Jesus said, "Except you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins." John 8, verse 24. 2 Corinthians 7, verse 10, that godly repentance is what leads us to salvation. Not repentance of the world, but godly repentance. Jesus said in Matthew 10, verses 32 through 33, "He that confesses me before men, him will I confess before my Father which is in heaven. He that denies me before men, him will I deny before my Father which is in heaven." I love what Brother John mentioned, said today at the end of his lesson about, we want to hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." We don't want to hear, "Depart from me, you who work iniquity." Those who deny him will hear those words. But we who confess his name will hear the great words, "Enter into my joy." In Mark chapter 16, verse 16, we must believe and be baptized in order to be saved. Baptism is what saves us, in addition to the hearing, believing, repenting, and confessing, leading to baptism. But baptism is where we put on Christ. Baptism is where we encounter the blood of Christ, we wash away our sins, and rise to walk in newness of life. And then in Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10, we are to live faithfully throughout our lives, that though we will have hills and valleys, there will be times when our faith is challenged, there may be times when we fall away, but we can come back. As long as we're still alive, and as long as God is long-suffering to us, we have the opportunity to repent. Anyone who has not obeyed the gospel now has the opportunity. His words teach us what we must do. Those who have obeyed the gospel but then have fallen away, you can come back. Those who have obeyed and perhaps are sinning in some way, you can have your sins continually washed by the blood of Jesus. But you need to repent of those sins. You need to confess those sins before God and pray for forgiveness. And the blood of Jesus will continually cleanse us of all unrighteousness. This is the plan of salvation. We don't read this in the accounts of the centurion in Capernaum or with Cornelius of following this exact pattern. But Peter did say, "Who can forbid them baptism, to be baptized?" And we see that it was so necessary. It is necessary. It must do this in order to be saved. And thus Cornelius and his household were saved. At this time, we will go ahead and stand and sing our invitation song. And if there's anyone here who has need to respond to this invitation, or perhaps has other things to talk about, please come forward as we stand and sing our invitation song.
Come to Jesus, he will save you, though your sins as crimson glow. If you give your heart to Jesus, he will make it white as snow. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come today. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come today. Come to Jesus, do not tarry, enter in at mercy's gate. Oh, delay not till the morrow, lest thy coming be too late. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come today. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come today. Come to Jesus, dying sinner, other Savior there is none. He will share with you his glory in your pilgrimage is done. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come today. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come today.
You may be seated. Are there those here this evening that do not have a Lord's Supper cup that would like to partake this evening? All right. Before the Lord's Supper this evening, will please turn to Psalm number 167. 167. He loves me.
Why did the Savior heavenly and come to earth below, where men his grace would not receive, because he loves me so? He
Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this day that you bless us with, and we thank you for another time that we have to remember your Son and his sacrifice upon that cross. Father, we pray for those who will be taking of this memorial feast now, as we take of the bread, and remembering his body that was given for us. Father, pray that things said and done here in this part of our worship service will be pleasing to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's pray for the fruit of the vine. Heavenly Father, again, we humbly approach your throne. We thank you so much, Father, for the blood that was shed for us, for the price that was paid that we might have the hope of eternal life and have a path to be redeemed back to you, Father. We know our sins have separated us, and we're just so grateful that the blood that was shed upon that horrible cross of Calvary does give us that chance to be back with you, and help us, Father, now to partake of this memorial feast in such a way that's pleasing to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good to see everyone here tonight. I have a few announcements to go over. I've had some updates, some sad news. Sorry to hear about this. We got a phone call just before coming here. That's why Kathy's not with us tonight. Jeanette Muha called, said their son, Laird Muha, died in his sleep. And he was in Oklahoma. I don't know many details other than that he's the third of their sons to die. And I don't know how many sons they have, but so anyhow, she's kind of broken up over that, and let's keep her in our prayers. June Trotter is home now. This is good news. She's recuperating under home care, so this is a good thing to hear about. We heard about Tish Clark. Doctors were pleased with the result of her past operation. That's good news. Tish, the wife of Brother B.J. Clark, who's the director of the Memphis School of Preaching, for those who don't know. Those are the main announcements I have. Just remember the men's assignments for the month of October posted. Group 2 lunch, your luncheon sign-up is on the bulletin board. And Group 3 will have ours up sometime this week. And then the men's breakfast for Saturday, the 8th of October, at 8 a.m. at Garcia's. Let's not forget about that. Those are the announcements I have. Let's stand and sing our song of our closing song and have our closing prayer.
Song number 379. O for a faith that will not shrink.
Oh, for a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by every foe, that will not tremble on the brink of any earthly foe, that will not murmur a curse claim beneath a chasing rod.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we come again to Thee, thanking Thee for all the things You have given us, thanking You for the times that You have seen us do things wrong, and there have been people to have helped us, and we appreciate all the things that people have done for us, each and every one. And we thank Thee so much, our Heavenly Father, for all that You give us, both spiritual and material goods that You have given us, that You give us each and every day. We thank Thee for the elders, the deacons, and those that preach, those that teach, and those that do things that we often do not see, but we thank each and every person for their efforts. Our Father, we come to Thee and ask Thee to be with those that are ill, those are struggling, and be with the Muha family, our Heavenly Father, because they've lost so much in the last few years. We know for others that we pray for also. There are so many to pray for. Our Father, we ask Thee to continue to be with us. Help us during the week to set the example that we need to set. We ask Thee to help us to influence others every opportunity that we have and be open to study. We thank Thee again for all that You've given us, and we thank Thee mostly for Thy Son, Jesus, who died that we might live. We thank Thee again for all these blessings. We ask Thee to be with us. In Christ's holy name, we pray these things. Amen.